On this channel, I've told you about what one of the best tools that I have found for doing genealogical research, and that is the Watto tool on the DNA Painter website. Now, if you have never used this tool before, it is extremely useful in taking information about matches to a single person and being able to use those to figure out where your person fits in that family tree. And that's why it's really powerful, is because you're leveraging the information not from one match but from several matches in order to figure out where this person may fit. So let's go through some of the basic steps that you need to know in order to get started using the Watto tool. The first thing with using Watto is you need to identify who your target person is. Now, some people get confused on this, but what the target person is who you don't know where they fit into a family tree. For instance, if you are adopted, this could be yourself, where you've taken a DNA test, and now you have all these matches, and you want to figure out who your biological father was or your biological mother was. So you're going to use these matches to find that out. But it doesn't have to be you. It could be another relative. Let's say that you might have tested with an aunt, and you're trying to figure out where she fits into another family tree, because she's really not your full aunt, she's a half aunt that you found from this. So there's lots of ways that you can use this, but the first part is to identify who your target person is and understanding who that target person is. Basically, you don't know where the target person fits. So I'm going to start off in the Watto tool and name my target person as Jane Doe. And it has you enter in a birth year if you know the birth year. And if this is yourself or somebody else close to you, you probably do know what the birth year is. This can be very helpful in narrowing down where the target person fits into the family tree, because you know when they were born. And if you know when some of the other people were born, that can give you a clue besides just the DNA. So now that you have your target person set, what you need to do next is you need to identify a group of matches that are related to that target person and probably related to each other. Now, these matches can have any amount of shared DNA, but you want to have matches that have more than 40 centimorgans. So if all you have is matches less than 40 centimorgans, it's not going to work out very well. But if you have some that have more than 40 centimorgans and maybe a couple with less than 40 centimorgans, that's fine. So in my example here, I'm going to use these people: Steve, Roberta, Don, Sarah, Jean, Darla, and Harold all share DNA with Jane Doe. And they happen to all share DNA with each other as well, because they are somewhat closely related. Now, how do you find this group of matches? Well, that is going to be through some different methods. Maybe you're doing a leads chart and you find a cluster that's related together, or you do one of the auto clusters and you're looking at those people that fit within one of those auto clusters. The key here is that you need to find this group of people that is all related together and related to your target person. So then we get to, I guess, the really fun part here, and that is building the tree of those matches. Now, we're not going to build the tree of the target person, because remember, the target person, we don't know where they fit into this tree. But because the target person matches all of these people, and if you have the tree information for all of these people back to a recent common ancestor, then your target person should probably be fitting in that tree somewhere. All right, so on what are the odds, we are going to start building the tree. And for that, we need to start basically here with the most recent common ancestor. And you can actually go backwards if you want, but I'm going to start with the most recent common ancestor because I found that from researching these different people. And we can add children to that and, of course, name them. And the nice thing here is we can continue to add children down the line however many generations we want. Now, typically, for most of these Watto trees, I've found that you're probably going to have maybe 5 to 7 generations, unless it is something that is really close. And so we can add multiple children to the same people. We can go back and add children to people we've already added. All of these things to help build this tree that you've already created or already researched in order to find where this most recent common ancestor is. So in Watto, you build a tree actually sideways like this. And you can see here that I've gone through and I've filled in everybody that I know. And there's Steve and Roberta and Don and Sarah and Jean and Darla and Harold. And they all relate back to this ancestral couple, Philip and Mary Ann Schnell. Now, this worked because I happened to have found trees for all of these people. And there was some other people I added into this tree, some other siblings that were not on their trees, but because of some other tree information, I was able to add that in. And so now I have a Watto tree that is ready to do some analysis on. You'll notice here that Jane Doe doesn't appear in this tree, and that's the way it's supposed to be because Jane Doe is who we're trying to find. We actually want to find out where in this tree Jane Doe fits. The next thing we want to do is we want to add in the shared DNA that each one of these people have with the target person. Now, if this target person is you, that's going to be really easy to find because you just simply go down your match list and see how much DNA you have with these people. If this is somebody else, then you may have to do some more searching. 23andMe and MyHeritage will actually give you this information, although you have to just dig down a little bit further to in order to find it. GEDmatch, you can find this information as well because it is an open database where anybody can look at any of the people that are in there in the public side. However, if you are looking at family tree DNA data or ancestry data, if you don't have access to the target person's profile, then you may not be able to get all of that DNA information. So, what can you do is really contact these different matches to see how much they share with this target person. Next, what we want to do is add the shared centimorgans for each one of these people. Now, this amount of shared centimorgans can come from any of the websites. The key here, though, is you're looking for the amount of shared centimorgans with each one of these people to your target person. So in Watto here, I have now added in all of the DNA for these target people. And you can actually see that this has some people that are pretty closely related. They share 900 centimorgans in one case with the target person, or 1147 centimorgans in another case. So this is actually going to be a really simple Watto tree just because I have all these matches that share a huge amount of DNA with my target person. Every Watto tree is not necessarily going to be this easy. But I've gone in and I've put all that DNA information in. Now, one of the things that you may see here is you may see that Sarah is the daughter of Dawn. And in that case, I really don't need Sarah's information. Since all of her DNA that is shared came through Dawn, I could actually leave Sarah off this. I've left it in there for right now. But when Watto does its calculations, it's going to ignore Sarah in this case. So if you have a parent's DNA, you don't need that child's DNA. Now, the next step then is to generate hypotheses. These hypotheses are where Jane may fit into the tree. They are guesses based on statistics of which location she could be in. So if I take a look at my Watto tree and I hit on the generate hypotheses, you can do this automatically with this button, or you can manually put them in if you want to. Now, this automatic one is taking into account not only how much DNA is shared, but also the age of the person. So, for instance, we know that if somebody died before, let's say, 2010, it's very unlikely that there's going to be any DNA information on that person. So all of these people that we have DNA with, they are still alive, or they at least were alive sometime after 2010. That gives you a rough idea of when they possibly could have been born, which the computer is then comparing with the birth year that you've put in yourself. So you can see from this, it has come up with four hypotheses that it thinks might be where this person is, our target person, Jane Doe. Each one of these hypotheses has a score attached to it. This is where people start to get a little bit confused. You are going to be looking for the highest number on that score, but that is just in relation to this tree. It is not in relation to any other tree. So for instance, the high score here happens to be 63. I have seen trees where the high score is in the thousands or even in the tens of thousands. And that all has to do with what matches you have and where they fit in the tree as far as the possibility of your target person for it. What it doesn't mean is that a tree that has a high score of 10,000 is not necessarily better than this tree with a high score of 63. What you want to look at actually is the relative values between the scores on a particular tree. And that goes to our next step, which is we want to research the highest possibilities. So let's pull up these hypotheses here. Now, these hypotheses can be found by just scrolling down on the page and give you an idea about what this means. So first off, we have hypothesis one, which is that Jane Doe is the child of Walter and the grandchild of Cora Faye. We also have hypothesis three, which Jane Doe is a child of an unknown sibling and the grandchild of Cora Faye. You notice there, they're still both the grandchild of Cora Faye. The score on both of these is 63. Now, since the score is 63, you'll notice that what it says is it's a similar likelihood to the next hypothesis. So these are each equal, and it's really because we're talking about a grandchild of this person. So if Jane Doe is a grandchild of this person, well, whether they're a grandchild through one sibling or a grandchild through another sibling that is not represented on the tree, those are equal amounts there. So that is the first place that we're going to want to research. We're going to want to research any children of Cora Faye and see whether or not Jane could have been the grandchild then of Cora Faye. Now, next we go down to hypothesis two, and this is that Jane Doe is the child of daughter and the grandchild of Cora Faye. Now, this is through a different line. The daughter is unnamed here, but it is a daughter that we have some DNA from another of that daughter's children. You'll notice, though, that the score is 3. And compared to the hypothesis right above, it says that it's about 21 times more likely than the next hypothesis. And this is what I mean about looking at it in relative terms. 63 is 21 times 3. And so, really, you'd have to have about 21 examples of this to just have one example that actually is where the hypothesis 2 falls in. So, it doesn't mean that hypothesis 2 is not possible. What it means is that it's 21 times more likely it's one of the other two rather than this one. And then finally, we have hypothesis 4. That Jane Doe is the child of Cora Ray. And you notice that is a score of 1. So it's actually 63 times more likely that Jane Doe is the grandchild of Cora Ray through either Walter or some other unknown person who was not put on the chart than that Jane Doe is the child of Cora Ray. So to me, that tells me that, yeah, this one at the bottom, I'm not really going to worry about until I've eliminated all possibilities from the other ones. And in particular, I'm going to be focused on Walter and any other kids that Cora Ray might have had. Now, if you happen to have enough information, you might have it so that all hypotheses except for one are eliminated. And if that's the case, there's an extremely good chance that hypothesis is the actual location of where your target person fits. But you're going to need to have a lot of DNA data in order to get a water tree like that. For all these other trees, and really for 99% of the trees that I have created, you're going to have to go and then do some more research on these highest possibilities. Watto is not going to tell you exactly who or where that person is, but Watto can tell you where to be looking that is most likely where you're going to find your answer. Now, if you'd like to learn something else about DNA, then you can watch this video up here. But if you'd like to learn something else about genealogy, then watch one of Devin's videos down below. But be sure to subscribe, and if you'd like to join FHF Extra, we have even more videos for you.